Good afternoon, everyone. I will introduce you my thesis entitled Synthesis of Iron Oxide Nanoparticles and Development of Magnetic Coatings by Fluid Processing. The thesis has been driven by André Thiaville and Clément Sanchez and supervised by Annelise Adenon-Angelvin at CEA. At first, I will detail the background and objectives of the project. The thesis is divided in three sections: the nanoparticle synthesis, a link between the microstructure and the magnetic properties, and then the development of magnetic coatings. At last, I will end by a conclusion on prospects. Polycrystalline bulk ferrite materials possess what we call a wide band magnetic behavior regarding their permeability as a function of the frequency. This behavior is due to the dispersed magnetic texture of the materials, and especially to the effect of the size and orientation of the grains. On the contrary, for a textured magnetic materials, for example, as a form of squares, the magnetic texture is governed by the pattern geometry, and the absorption bands are strictly linked to the microstructure in domains. This is the multiband magnetic behavior. The goal of the project is to develop an innovative material with controlled magnetic properties at desired frequencies and to reach a more frequency selective behavior. This is what we called at last the multiband magnetic behavior. These kind of properties are interesting for electromagnetic applications, for example, like RFID antenna, recording industry, wireless power transfer, or radar absorption. I would like to focus on a more specific applications in the context of RFID. RFID possesses a lot of applications. For example, in contactless payment, with an operating frequency at around 13 megahertz. And the aim here is to limit the magnetic losses of the material at this using frequency. In order to tune the magnetic losses of the material at desired frequencies, the project deals with the development of micro-pattern networks of magnetic oxides by fluid processing. Two stages are to control. On the one hand, the microstructure, namely the grain size spread and the porosity of coatings. On the other hand, the magnetic pattern and especially the shape effect. The project is divided in four steps before obtaining the final material: the nanoparticle synthesis, the fluid formulation, the coating process, and then the thermal treatment. In this presentation, I will only focus on the nanoparticle synthesis, the coating process, and the thermal treatment. First and foremost, I will detail the nanoparticle synthesis. The chemical composition chosen for the study is a system of a spinel ferrite of zinc, with a zinc doping in order to obtain a mixed insulating oxide and to allow a good penetration of electromagnetic wave in the material. The spinel ferrite system crystallizes in a cubic structure divided in octahedral and tetrahedral sites, and the different cations, namely zinc, iron 2, and iron 3, are located at both sites. Regarding the literature, a first composition has been fixed at Zn 0.4, Fe 2.604, in order to combine insulating properties with a high saturation magnetization. In addition, two research sites have been researched for the project. At first, for diameters below 20 nanometer, written SPFM particles. And then a nanometer and 1 micron, written FM particles. I have synthesized the nanoparticles by thermal decomposition, and I have compared two different ways of heating. The first one is the conventional heating in a heating mantle. The precursors are acetyl acetonates. The solvent is benzyl ether, and oleic acid has been used as a surfactant. I have transferred and adjusted the conventional heating to the microwave heating because microwave heating is well known to be a more controlled and more homogeneous way of heating. The precursors are the same, but the reaction medium is different and is constituted of oleolamine, oleic acid, octadecene, and ethylene glycol. I have characterized the different nanoparticles obtained through the two heating routes. For the conventional route, the nanoparticle possess different morphologies like cubes, polyhedra, but are heterogeneous in size and shape, and the synthesis are non-reproducible. On the other hand, in the case of a microwave heating, the nanoparticles are, as you can see, homogeneous in size and shape, and perfectly reproducible. The drawback here is that only a few solvents are suitable to interact with microwave. As a conclusion, the microwave route has been chosen for the overall study. I have studied the effect of a different solvent used in the reaction medium, and at first, the suitability of the solvents for the microwave heating. As you can see, you have a table with the dielectric properties of the different solvents. It appears that oleolamine, oleic acid, and octadecene are poor microwave absorbers due to their low dielectric properties. It is not the case for the ethylene glycol because ethylene glycol has higher dielectric properties. Thus, the addition of ethylene glycol in the and allows to increase the particle diameters. Indeed, the addition of ethylene glycol have allowed the formation of raspberry types morphologies for the nanoparticles. This atypical morphology is attributed to a binding of crystallites through the terminations of ethylene glycol and has been previously obtained in the literature with similar synthesis using ethylene glycol too. The effect of the addition of ethylene glycol of the particle diameter has been also examined. The particle diameter increases until a certain amount of ethylene glycol in the reactor and then sharply decreases. Moreover, a secondary phase of zinc oxide appears above a certain amount of ethylene glycol, which highlights the poor homogenization of precursors in the reactor for too large amounts of ethylene glycol. I have also investigated the influence of oleolamine and oleic acid on the synthesis. Oleolamine and oleic acid are multifunctional reactants, which can act as surfactants, wetting agents, solvents, complexing and reducing agents. In this presentation, I will only focus on the influence of such solvents on the nanoparticle size and morphology. You find here the trend of the particle size as a function of a volume ratio between oleolamine and oleic acid. As you can see, the particle size decreases with increasing this volume ratio. And there is a transition between two different types of morphologies, between polyhedrons and spheres. Thus, the two solvents have complementary functions. If oleolamine allows to slow down the particle growth, oleic acid enables the growth along the preferential axis and leads to the formation of elongated particles. In conclusion, octadecene has been only added in order to homogenize or solubilize the precursors. At the end of the synthesis, I have selected two systems of nanoparticles. The first one are SPFM particles, which are spherical with a narrow size distribution around 6.2 nanometer. The second one are FM particles with a larger size distribution due to their typical raspberry morphologies and with a mean diameter around 22.4 nanometer. These nanoparticles have been deeply characterized, and at first, their chemical properties at global and local scales. At global scale, the chemical composition has been analyzed through an ICP-AES analysis, and the ratio between zinc and iron has been retrieved, and it is close to the theoretical one. At the local scale, chemical mappings have also allowed to obtain the ratio between zinc and iron, and it is also close to a theoretical one. Thus, there is a good agreement between theoretical, global, and local compositions, which highlights the good homogeneity of the chemical composition in both systems of nanoparticles. The nanoparticles have been also characterized through other means of characterizations, allowing to establish a link between the microstructure and the magnetic properties. And at first, the effect of the size of the nanoparticles on their magnetic properties have been analyzed through Mossbauer spectroscopy at 377 Kelvin by Jean-Marc Grenèche at IMMM at Le Mans. In the case of SPFM particles, at 77 Kelvin, the spectrum is constituted of a wide and single line. At 300 Kelvin, there are two contributions, a quadrupolar doublet and a large single one. These atypical curves traduce the superparamagnetic relaxation in the particles. The SPFM particles are thus superparamagnetic. Basically, the superparamagnetism is evidenced in tiny nanoparticles with a diameter below 20 nanometer, and it could be evidenced through characterization techniques with a measuring time above the reversal time between two different orientations of magnetic moment inside the particles. The blocked state of the particles could be also observed for decreasing temperature because the reversal time increases for decreasing temperature. On the contrary, for FM particles, the spectra are only constituted of magnetic sextets at both temperature. The particles are thus not superparamagnetic here, but ferromagnetic. I have verified these two different magnetic behaviors by a vibrating sample magnetometer measurement. Different shapes of hysteretic cycles have been observed. In the case of SPFM particles, the signal does not saturate at high values of field. The nanoparticles are thus superparamagnetic. The signal has been fitted with a Langevin function, and the recovered saturation magnetization is in total agreement with a squid measurement at 2 Kelvin. The obtained saturation magnetization for both systems of nanoparticles are a bit lower in comparison with nanoparticles of the same composition in the literature, but for a dense layer. This gap could be explained by several reasons: spin counting, cationic distribution, or oxidation. In the case of the spin counting, the thicknesses of the surface spin counting of particles have been determined from in-field Mossbauer spectroscopy. The particles are here assimilated to core shell structure with a dead layer at the surface due to the surface spin counting. From the thicknesses of surface spin counting, magnetization of a core could be calculated from the following formula. In addition, microstructural observations at ICTS in Madrid have allowed to observe the cationic distribution inside the nanoparticles, and especially an HADF imaging coupled to HILS have allowed to detect the position of atoms in the structure, and especially the inversion degree. What is exactly the inversion degree? If we remember the structure, the spinel structure of the particles divided in tetrahedral and octahedral sites, the zinc, iron 2 and iron 3 cations are localized at both sites. And sometimes you can have a switch between a zinc and an iron 3, which leads to the inversion of the structures and which have a real impact on the magnetic properties of the particles. In these microstructural observations, it is clear that the zinc cations are localized at both tetrahedral and octahedral sites in the case of FM particles with a 0.4 amount of zinc, which evidences the inversion degree of the spinel. This previous result has been confirmed by a more quantitative technique through X-ray diffraction with a red velvet analysis. It has been performed at ICPMS in Strasbourg by Christophe Lefebvre. And the amount of zinc localized at the octahedral sites have been quantified. It is clear that the cations are randomly distributed in the structure and that it is affected by the synthesis route and conditions. This inversion degree in the structure has been also quantified through Mossbauer spectroscopy, and the value obtained for the zinc localized at the octahedral sites is in agreement with the one obtained through X-ray diffraction. From these values of cationic distribution, the magnetic moment of particles have been calculated using a random localized counting model based on the molecular field theory. As you can see, the calculated magnetic moment is far from the one measured for the particles. It is thus required to consider another parameter, for example, the particle oxidation. I have observed the particle oxidation through the iron oxygen bond band of the particles in infrared spectroscopy. In the literature, this band is wide and single in the case of magnetite and multiple in the case of magnemite. Thus, SPFM particles are not pure zinc substituted magnetite. There is the presence of zinc substituted magnemite and the particles are oxidized. It seems that for FM particles, the particles are not oxidized. A first hypothesis could be stated here with the core shell structure of particles with an oxidation layer at the surface. The oxidation of particles have been also demonstrated by Mossbauer spectroscopy. From the isomer shift, the proportions of zinc substituted magnetite and magnemite have been estimated. And it reveals that SPFM particles are pure zinc substituted magnemite and are thus completely oxidized, and that FM particles are a mixture of both phases and are in fact oxidized too. In-field Mossbauer spectroscopy have also allowed to estimate the proportions of iron 3 and iron 2 in tetrahedral and octahedral sites of the spinal structure. And from these values, the obtained calculated magnetic moments for particles is really close to the one measured for the particles. Thus, the magnetic moment of particles has been retrieved. If we take into account the surface spin counting, the cationic distribution, and also the particle oxidation. In addition, the permeability measurements of particles have been carried out at CA and compared for both systems of particles. SPFM particles display a broad resonance with a low amplitude. On the contrary, FM particles display a resonance with a larger amplitude by a factor 14. Thus, the level of permeability and the resonance frequency are clearly modified by the particle size and by the superparamagnetism effect. In temperature, permeability measurements have also allowed to study the balance between magnetic anisotropy energy and thermal energy with temperature. In the case of FM particles, it is clear that there is no effect of temperature on the permeability measurements. However, for SPFM particles, three trends have been evidenced for decreasing temperature: a shift of the resonance frequency toward high frequencies, an increase of the resonance amplitude, and a decrease of the width of a resonance peak. The three trends have been fitted using a dynamic susceptibility model with the collaboration of Nikola Vukadinovic, which works at Dassault. This model has been proposed by Reker and Schlomis. Three hypotheses are important. The particles are randomly distributed. They are spherical with a unique domain and an uniaxial magnetic anisotropy. A ratio sigma between the magnetic anisotropy energy KV and the thermal energy KBT has been estimated. And from these three hypotheses, the transverse dynamic susceptibility has been expressed through the following formula to fit the previous curves. In order to apply the previous model, it is important to have an idea of the order of magnitude of the anisotropy constant K of SPFM particles. Three methods have allowed to calculate this value. First one, from the coercive field of FM particles at 300 Kelvin, the Stoner-Volbach model. The second one, from a fit of a hysteresis loop of FM particles at 300 Kelvin with a low of approach to saturation. And the last one, from the blocking temperature of SPFM particles. From the three methods, K has been estimated in the range of 10^3 to 10^5 ARG per cubic centimeter. The values obtained in the literature for particles with the same composition is comprised in this estimated range. Considering the anisotropy constant and the saturation magnetization independent of the temperature, poor fits of the model with the experimental curves have been obtained, as you can see on the graph. It is thus required to consider the anisotropy constant and the saturation magnetization dependent of the temperature, and the fit here reproduces well the experimental curves, as you can see on the graph. Thus, we have to consider the trend of the anisotropy field with temperature, which decreases with increasing temperature. And this trend is in agreement with the literature. After nanoparticle synthesis, magnetic coatings have been developed from SPFM and FM particles. I have studied two different coating processes, airbrushing and inkjet printing. Airbrushing has a lot of advantages. It is an easy way of elaboration with an easy liquid formulation with a simple dispersion of particles. The drawback here is that there is it is necessary to use a post-processing step of laser etching in order to pattern the layers, and the process is manual. The second process, the inkjet printing, is an innovative process allowing to elaborate patterned layers in a single step. It is an automatized process, and there is a possibility to introduce a module of laser sintering directly on the machine. The drawbacks here are the ink formulation, which is tricky, the process handling, and some drying issues, like, for example, the coffering effect. Regarding the airbrushing, this technique is assimilated to a spray. It deals with the nebulization of a solution on a substrate. The coating quality is influenced by the nozzle aperture, the working distance, the speed, and the number of applications. I have optimized the process of coating through airbrushing. After the particle synthesis, the particles have been recovered through a first centrifugation process. After the particle recovery, the particles have been cleaned in order to remove all of the residual organics coming from the synthesis. A compromise has to be found between the number of cleanings and the residual organics, and it has been fixed at 6 cleanings. After cleanings, I have stabilized the particles in a suitable liquid in order to counter the interactions between the particles to avoid particle aggregation and sedimentation. The particles have been stabilized in exam through oleic acid as a surfactant, through two specific groups of oleic acid, through the hydrocarbon chains, which have a good affinity with hexan, and the carboxylate groups, which graft onto the particle surface. From this stable dispersion, continuous coatings have been elaborated by airbrushing. The second allowing the elaboration of pattern networks in a single step, there are two major constraints, the clogging and the destabilization of nozzles. For this process, it is required to formulate a compatible ink in terms of viscosity, surface tension, and above all of these parameters, ejection ratio, which has to be comprised between 1 and 10, and which is strictly linked to the viscosity and surface tension of the ink. I have retained two different ink formulations. The first one in a polymer based with a mixture of poly 1 desen in hexan. The second one, a solvent based with a mixture of octanol in hexan. The ejection ratios of these two formulations are comprised in the desired range to be compatible with the machine. Regarding the results with through ejections and printing, it appears that the SF formulation allows to reduce the topping of a nozzle plate and a faster drying of patterns. Thus, even if the quality of coatings is less resolved with the SF formulations, this last formulation has been retained and larger patterns have been printed. After the elaboration of coatings, The coating has to be thermal treated under argon in order to avoid the layer's oxidation. The thermal treatment is divided in two steps, a debinding step at 450 degrees in order to remove all of the residual organics from the layers, and the sintering step at 770 degrees in order to densify the layer. The decomposition of the organics in the layers occurs in three steps. The first one at 190 degrees with the removal of the residual water and solvents. The second one with the thermal degradation of oleylamine groups and hydrocarbon chains of oleic acid at 280 degrees. And the last one with the degradation of carboxylate groups of oleic acid at higher temperature at around 350 degrees. I have observed the effect of these two steps on conus coatings elaborated by airbrushing. The SPFM coatings have been already cracked after the debinding step, which is not the case for the FM coatings. However, after sintering, both coatings are cracked, and the huge porosity have been evidenced in the FM coatings. This cracking has been attributed to the shrinkage and the adherence of the layer to the substrate, which induces a lot of constraints, and the reduction of the spinel into zinc versus at higher temperature and due to the degradation of the organics at high temperature. Even if the layers are cracked, a feasibility test of laser etching has been done. The goal here was to determine at which moment before or after debinding it is better to etch the layers in order to avoid the cracking and to have a better adherence of patterns. And it appears that the layers have to be etched after sintering. As a conclusion, I have developed an overall process from the particle synthesis to the elaboration of magnetic coatings in order to obtain the desired magnetic properties. Homogeneous in size and shape and reproducible nanoparticles have been synthesized by a microwave-assisted thermal decomposition synthesis. The nanoparticles have been deeply characterized, and the link between the microstructure and the magnetic properties have been established. Their experimental magnetic moments have been retrieved by considering their structure as core shell structures with an oxidation layer and a surface spin coating. In the future, it should be interesting to study the model of oxidation more locally through, for example, X-ray magnetic circular dichroism or small angle neutron scattering. After the particle synthesis, continuous coatings have been elaborated by airbrushing from a dispersion of the particles in exam, and this process has been successfully transferred to inkjet printing. The cracking noticed in coatings after the thermal treatment has been attributed to shrinkage of the layers and the phase reduction of the phase at high temperatures. The cracking of coatings have led to poor density of coatings and thus to weak signals of imaginary permeability, which are clearly not enough to have the desired multiband magnetic response. Thus, many prospects have been identified in order to improve the coating density and to obtain a better dynamic magnetic response at different scales of the process. On the one hand, concerning the processing method, different methods could be tried, with, for example, a microwave-assisted solvothermal method without a post-annealing treatment, the spraying of precursor solutions on a heating spanner. These two methods could be transferred to inkjet printing in order to obtain patterned layers, and also the crack patterning. On the other hand, another thermal densification technique could be tried, which is the laser etching, because laser sintering occurs less cracking in the material due to local heating. I will end by a different approach, which is to introduce a sacrificial layer between the substrate and the coating in order to reduce the constraints and to reduce the cracking. Thank you for your attention.